I think storytelling is really cool. I totally get that saying storytelling is cool sounds dumb, but I just think it's neat. From the fun improv of a D&D podcast to the subdued environmental storytelling of a FromSoft game, one of my favorite ways to experience a story is one that I think is very underappreciated, and that's the story told through a fight. I recently got around to watching the 2011 cult action film, The Raid. Now, I'm not going to blow anyone's minds by saying that the movie is great, although while I was watching it, I got nervous going into the final fight. I didn't think the final opponent, a man simply known as Mad Dog, was properly built up for the protagonist, Rama. You see, up until this point, Rama has gone through every challenge that has come his way, fighting countless men and leaving ruin in his wake. While definitely not getting out unscathed, he's made it here. Compare this to Mad Dog, who we've only seen fight one person before now. Yes, Mad Dog does win quite quickly against an established character, but that's the only chance we get to see him in action before the climactic fight. Not only is Mad Dog going up against the undefeated Rama, but also his brother Andy, making it seem like more and more of an uphill battle for its antagonist. Then the fight happens and all my worries evaporated. Every fight tells a story. The story of Rama and Andy versus Mad Dog is that Mad Dog is a goddamn monster. He wanted to fight the both of them, and for good reason. It's the only way it's a fair fight, and even then, just barely. The two brothers throw everything they have at Mad Dog, and he just seems to counter or block it. Mad Dog is smaller than the other two men, but he knows how to use his size to his advantage better than they can use it against him. The few times they manage to get a hit on him, they can't put him down. In fact, it barely seems like they're able to do anything. The only way Rama and Andy actually win in the end is by taking advantage of Mad Dog's one weakness, his preference to kill with his bare hands. I put a spoiler warning at the beginning of this, although I don't think it's a spoiler to say that the good guy wins. It's a movie and that's generally how these things go. It's about how we get there that matters. Over the course of 7 minutes, I went from thinking that Rama was too unstoppable for the ending to be satisfying, to being amazed that he managed to get out of there. All of course being done with no dialogue, no voiceover, just the performance of three men in a room beating the shit out of each other. This type of physical storytelling, I think, often gets looked down upon because it's fighting, which completely ignores the hard work and training these people do. People don't often give these performers, action film actors, stunt people, the appreciation they deserve. If they did, Mad Max would have won Best Picture in 2015. If award shows wanted to mean shit, they would have put in a category for Best Stunt Performance. If this non-existent category did exist in 2011, it should have gone to Aiko Uwais or Yaya Lihan for their performances in The Raid. Fighting and stunts as a means of storytelling is something I wish we saw more in action movies today. I wish we saw more of a focus on nuance between characters rather than big spectacle. I can get this itch scratched somewhere else, and that's in pro wrestling.
Oh, the lockjaw applied on the downward pressure. What are you doing? The Madman!
I spent a lot of time trying to explain wrestling to people, and I do end up explaining wrestling a lot as a fan because most people don't get it or may never get it, and that's okay. If you think you could be interested, allow me to explain why it's so special. I've called it fight porn, murder gymnastics, live-action battle anime, and while I think that last point is actually very accurate, I think a more widely understandable description would be action theater. It's set on a stage with an audience, light and music play a huge part in its presentation, and the acting present is often bold and overstated. It could be described as overacting, but hey, even the people in the nosebleed seats need to know what's going on. You might be asking, why would I have to explain wrestling as a whole? WWE is massive. They sell out arenas. They have three TV shows that average near or over 1 million views every week. What's there to explain? Well, there is minor stuff like lingo to get into, what is a heel, what is a face, but WWE is what's to explain. WWE isn't really wrestling, and I'd argue that wrestling hasn't really been popular in the US since the early 90s. Now, before you come at me for saying that WWE isn't wrestling and that you're 90% sure one of those W's stands for wrestling, that is true, but allow me to explain. So, cards on the table, I'm not the biggest fan of WWE in any way. I am going to ask you to believe me when I say that's not why I would say something like WWE as it is currently hurts wrestling. The company itself doesn't call its product wrestling, and hasn't for literal decades. WWE makes sports entertainment.
Sports entertainment.
A marketing term originally invented by Vince McMahon in 1989 to pay less taxes on WWE live events, but I'd argue this is a mentality that has warped the entire company. The independent contractors that work there aren't wrestlers, they're superstars, Everything within WWE feels distinctly them and not in a way I think is good. Most WWE matches feel the same. It's a heel beating up the face until they get their comeback and win. The production is also super bright and clean. I've seen WWE live events. It's insane to see their stages in person, but they also start to feel superfluous when you compare them to the production of other major promotions. From my perspective, WWE would want you to think that they're the wrestling version of the NFL or the NBA. That's not the case. Yes, they are the biggest wrestling promotion in the world despite not having wrestlers or putting on wrestling events. Ever since a newer company like AEW hit the scene, they're right on WWE's tails in terms of size in the US, and if you go outside America, you'll see NJPW or CMLL. Why does this matter? What does any of this actually have to do with how great wrestling is high art, or why wrestling isn't more widely popular in the US? And that's because sports entertainment isn't wrestling, it's nostalgia. Earlier when I said wrestling hasn't really been popular since the early 90s is because in the mid and especially late 90s is when WWE started to focus less on the quality of in-ring work and more on everything around it. Bret Hart and other wrestlers of his era are some of the last that people really cared about his character as an athlete being the champion. This transition was put on display in 1997 when he left the company under some weird circumstances. And we were seeing the likes of Steve Austin and Dwayne Johnson get the spotlight. I would be actually insane to say that people didn't like Stone Cold or The Rock. People loved them, but people didn't love them because of their wrestling, they loved them because of what they embodied. The Rock is a well-documented human ball of charisma, and despite having friends who watch wrestling and listen to many wrestling shows, I've never heard someone say that a Rock match was their favorite, or even in their top 10 or top anything. The only time I hear people mention his in-ring work is when they talk about his WrestleMania X7 match, his once-in-a-lifetime match against John Cena and their rematch, or the super uncomfortable match against Mick Foley. I never heard anyone talk about their quality, just that they happen. When it comes to Steve Austin, it's honestly pretty similar. People talk more about his matches than The Rock, but when the WWE Attitude Era, the name of this late 90s, early aughts era, was at its peak, people loved Steve Austin because he drank beer and beat up his boss. WWE was the embodiment of this edgy, in-your-face attitude that was so popular at the time. Most WWE TV episodes in the Attitude Era were heavy on segments not in the ring, and when they would do matches, they were mostly short and forgettable. This would take the focus of the shows away from the in-ring work, telling the audience that part doesn't matter. WWE's affiliation with the 90s leads a lot of people to think that wrestling is something of a bygone era. This is only reinforced when pop culture references wrestling. Mainly rappers referencing older wrestlers or TV shows about wrestling like Netflix's Glow being set in the 80s. Now, TV shows about wrestling setting themselves in the 80s does make sense from a production standpoint. Wrestling was much more simple in production and in terms of in-ring style, so it's easier to recreate with actors. The rapper references also make sense because they're just referencing something they liked as kids or older songs that were just referencing pop culture then.
Yo, I slayed them C's back in the rec room era. My style broke motherfucking backs like him for terror.
Next up, the Godfather Don making his way against the Undertaker and the Ultimate Warrior.
Mike, looky here. It's just the way the cookie tear. Prepare to get hurt and mangle like Kurt Angle, rookie year.
Play out a week, Monday night with The Rock. I'm Vince McMahon with a beat. Power slamming them hammers.
I Jake Snake him. DDT him in mausoleum.
Many music artists today would have been kids when the WWE was at its peak and probably loved it, but then they found out that it's not real. As a fan of this weird form of entertainment, one of the most annoying things someone can say is that wrestling is fake. It doesn't bug me because I think everything is 100% legit. Yeah, no shit. Many of my favorite wrestling angles involve heels attacking the faces after matches. Obviously, there would be major real-world consequences if someone did that. Like, if Kenta actually just attacked that many people, you would just fire his ass. Yes, it's silly to think that these shows aren't fiction. But that applies to all fiction. Earlier when I was talking about The Raid, I mentioned Rama, the character, beating every person he fought in that movie. I didn't say Iko Uwais killed hundreds of men, so the movie ruled. Bryan Cranston has never cooked meth. Breaking Bad, still good though. When two wrestlers go into the ring, they already know who's winning, but that's because they're telling a story. By the time you started watching Squid Game, the actors already knew what the ending was. If it didn't bother you there, why would it here? Also, saying that wrestling is fake is kind of belittling to what these performers put their body through just for our entertainment. Also, wrestling fans know it's a show. They get into it because it's amazing to watch live, and they love the performers. Anyone who loves pro wrestling knows that when you're trying to get someone into it, you don't recommend the best wrestling matches out there, because they're super fucking long compared to what most people expect. Look at some of Dave Meltzer's top wrestling matches. You'll notice the shortest in his top 10 is 22 minutes, with the average length of those 10 matches being around 40 minutes. These matches have a structure to them you can feel. The wrestlers are trying to make sure they can actually work a match that long. I don't think longer matches are inherently better, but it makes sense that someone like myself or Dave Meltzer would be a fan of them because they allow for more nuance. Wrestlers can take their time to tell more character-driven stories, like Jay White starting many of his big matches sliding out of the ring, or Kazuchika Okada doing his fake-out chops. Little things like this can achieve a multitude of ideas. They inform us, the audience, that Jay White is a little rat bastard, and Okada likes to get into the heads of his opponents. It also slows down the match, gives the performers time to breathe and get into it. They can also take this time to start setting things up. The reason Jay White rolls out of the ring is so he can make the face go after him. When they do chase him, his manager can attack them, he can throw them into the barricade, he can roll back in and try to attack the face when they try to get back into the ring. Like I said, Jay White is a rat bastard. He's setting the tone that he will do anything to win, so his opponents need to watch their back. As a story, you could think of this as the first act of a narrative. As a fight, this can also be compared to the first round of an MMA match. The two fighters don't just go in and give it their biggest and hardest shot in the first 10 seconds, because if you mess up, you could pay for it and end up losing just as quickly as you thought you'd win. The fighters know they have time, so they use that first round to try and figure out how their opponent is going to react, then use what they learned later in the fight. You can apply the same logic to the first 10 or even 15 minutes of a title match that has a 60-minute time limit. Take your time, learn, then start to ramp up. It can be hard to pin down exactly when a match does kick into that second or third act, but if I had to put it to paper, I would say the typical three-act structure of a wrestling match would be Act 1 is setup. This is the two performers setting up the dynamic of a wrestling match. This can be your tag partner getting beat up, setting up a certain level of violence, or someone with a cast on his hand not being able to punch someone because the cast counts as a weapon. Act 2 would be the rising action. This is where you start to see more frequent near falls, bigger spots. Act 3 is payoff. Seeing that tag team overcome the odds, having that violent match go places you didn't expect, or seeing that guy with cast punch that other dude. On occasion, the act change is something more tangible. The Young Bucks vs. Lucha Bros inside a steel cage comes to mind. I went in that match thinking it was basically a lock that the Young Bucks were losing. The match had been great, but the Bucks had been the champions for a while, and it seemed like the right time for the Lucha Bros to get the titles. Then Brandon Cutler threw a bag of assorted dangerous things for the Young Bucks, and the moment I saw... Okay, I'm going to be honest here. I just put YB in my script. I didn't remember if it was Matt Jackson or Nick Jackson. I'm sure I'll remember when I'm looking at the clip and I can tell which one it is. But for the time being, I just have YB in stars. Anyways, the moment I saw
Matt Jackson
bring out a spiked shoe, I started thinking, shit, are the Young Bucks actually going to win? For the first time in this match, I was actually uncertain and stayed that way until the match came to its climactic end. I'm not going to spoil this one. If you don't mind some blood, I recommend it. It's Dave Meltzer's number 10 match of all time. That makes it number 1 for steel cage matches, number 2 for tag matches. Number 1 is Kenny Omega and Adam Page versus the Young Bucks, which is number 4 overall. For the record, I don't love Dave Meltzer. I think he said some dumb stuff. He's just a dude who refused wrestling. Just because he thinks a match is great doesn't mean you will. He has watched a lot of wrestling, though. He's been reviewing it since his publication. The Wrestling Observer newsletter started literally 40 years ago, so I hope he'd have a pretty decent grip on what's good. Even with me using him as a point of reference, I definitely don't always agree with him. I think his reviews are too often boiled down to the star ranking, when he gives a match a grade anywhere between 0 and 5 stars, ideally. He's broken the star ranking system 53 times, giving matches either a 5.25, 5.5, 5.75, or even 6 stars on a 5-star ranking system. Only once has he given the prestigious honor of 6.25 stars, and only once has he given the equally rare but much more meaningful 7 out of 5 stars. Wrestling is also like any other form of media. There are the everyday, yeah, that was fun matches, but when a match is great, they're unlike anything you'll see anywhere else. Great music, movies, theater, or comics all use their format to do something that couldn't be done in any other medium. Wrestling is that same way. A match that I love is one that Dave Meltzer only gave 5 stars. A match that I think embodies this unique storytelling of wrestling. That match being Kenny Omega versus Brian D. Danielson. The moment this match starts, the crowd is explosive. Before Omega or Danielson have even made contact with each other, the people are chanting, "Holy shit." For years, this match was something that people could only dream about, Danielson making his name in WWE while Omega made his in New Japan. But now, it's actually happening. Now, it had a problem. You see, Danielson had just joined this company, AEW, 2 weeks before this match, and he wasn't standing across the ring from just anyone but Kenny Omega, the AEW champion. As much as everyone wanted this match, AEW is rightfully very protective of who faces their champion. A title match isn't something you are given, it's something you work for. Even if you did great things elsewhere, once you're here, you have to do the work just like anyone else. We'd seen big names join and show their interest in the title, but they still had to win matches to get it. This match was deemed to be a non-title match, so if Kenny loses, he would still be the champion. But do you really want your top guy getting beat by someone who people are still referring to as an ex of your biggest competitor? At the same time, Danielson is new to AEW. What would having him join and then instantly lose say about you as a company? Will you bring in underutilized talent just to keep misusing them? Then the fight happened and all my worries evaporated. Omega vs. Danielson is a masterclass on pacing. Throughout the match, Omega and Danielson managed to balance beating the ever-loving shit out of each other and still tell a coherent story. It never feels like it moves from one act to another too quickly. The flow of the match feels appropriate for these two fighters at the level they are. While they are laying out some devastating offense on each other, it still feels like the two fighters are trying to figure each other out. The match then ramps up when Omega starts to take advantage of Danielson's real-life history of neck injuries, but he can't keep Danielson down. The only way to talk about this match properly is to spoil its ending. The finish of this match is what makes it a complete piece. Bryan Danielson and Kenny Omega's dream match ends in a 30-minute time limit draw. On paper, this is an anticlimactic end, especially to a match that, to borrow a phrase, is good by default. There is no timeline where these two performers in their current state in their careers are going to have a bad match together. This isn't to say the match wouldn't be great without the finish. Kenny Omega has done something similar to this finish before, but not exactly. Look back to his 60-minute time limit draw against Kazuchika Okada at NJPW's Dominion from 2017. It's two men tired and desperately crawling at each other as the timer hits 60. Compare this to Danielson and Omega. They're still fighting. They aren't quitting. The closest thing to equate this to would be a movie or TV show ending on a cliffhanger. There's an idea in writing a scene of what happens to a character 2 seconds after this. I didn't want to talk about WWE again, but I am. Take this ending for example. Drew McIntyre closes the door to the cell. Randy Orton stands there with a chair in his hand, and it fades to black. What happens after this scene ends? Do they fight? Do security guards make Drew open the door and they walk out? Does Drew just open the door himself and then they walk away, but then they get caught in that awkward thing of already saying bye to someone, but you're walking in the same direction? What happens next? With Omega and Danielson, we see what happens next because it knows that it's happening in front of people. They keep fighting. They keep fighting until they're forcibly separated. Omega and Danielson isn't just a draw, it's acknowledging the fact that this is a live thing and happening in front of real people and using it to its advantage. Every match in AEW has a time limit, this one is no different. Earlier I mentioned the pace of a wrestling match. This match didn't hit its third act 20 minutes in. It hit its third act 29 minutes in. That's because these two aren't working a 30-minute bout. They're having a 40 or even 50-minute match under a 30-minute time limit. In another world with more time, these two would have had an ending, but that's not what they were given in the story, and that wasn't the goal of this story. This ending makes sense for these two characters and their setting. They are two top-level athletes performing at their peak, trying to figure each other out. This ending only works in the pro wrestling environment. So obviously this match had a big impact on me. It's one of my favorite matches ever, but I'm not telling you about it in the hopes that you'll watch it or even like it. I'm definitely not trying to get you to like it as much as me. I totally understand that I'm an outlier. I'm deep in there in terms of pro wrestling, and it would be impossible to ask everyone to dissect it the way I do, and I wouldn't want to. I also understand it's a very narrow type of storytelling. That doesn't make it bad, just specific. No one is going to tell a story like Citizen Kane in a wrestling ring. That's not what wrestling is for, and that doesn't make it a lower form of art because of it. I love music, but I couldn't break that down the same way I can wrestling. I can acknowledge the depth that it has, and I know I can go to others to learn about it, if I feel so inclined. that's ultimately my goal. Danielson versus Omega isn't even the only match I could talk about like this. I could go on equally long about Shingo Takagi versus Jeff Cobb from Wrestle Kingdom 15, which, by the way, if this video piqued your interest at all, go check out that match. It's like 15 minutes and I adore it. Because fighting is often delegated as violence, people don't want to give it a fair chance as something that can have depth. Now, all I hope for is, after watching this, you can appreciate the potential this type of storytelling has. I want more people to just consider what can be high art.